There comes a time in all traders' lives where they will seek to maximize the return they're generating on any given investment or any given pool of funds. Traditionally, this seeking of increasing returns comes via a series of mechanisms. It can either be by looking at instruments such as derivatives, such as options or futures or CFDs. More traditionally in the past, it has come about by the application of gearing or leverage to a portfolio. The use of borrowed funds to ramp up or turbocharge the returns of any given fund or group of stocks is not a new concept and has been with us for a very, very long time. Traditionally, when we look at this notion of gearing or leverage, there are two sorts that pop up as generic examples. The first is intrinsic. This is a function of the construction of the instrument. So what happens is that the borrowing becomes the responsibility of the people who have constructed the fund. Effectively, you outsource that to them and they take care of it. The other is extrinsic. This is generated by the use of borrowed funds. That is, you might have $100,000 sitting in your broking account, and you have the capacity to borrow, let's say, $50,000 more and invest that as well. In terms of examples of each, they're quite common. This is a snippet from the fact sheet PDF of the Beta Shares Geared Australian Equity Fund. Its code is GEAR, as you would expect. What this fund does is it seeks to replicate the ASX 200, but then apply gearing to that to lift the returns. So this is an example of intrinsic gearing. The gearing is handled by Beta Shares, who manage this particular fund. And these funds are quite common and they apply to a wide variety of markets. This is a similar tool which looks at gearing into the US market. And in the US, these sorts of funds are referred to as pro or ultra, and they seek to generate a multiple of the daily returns of a given instrument or a given share, given index. The earlier iteration of this, before these intrinsically geared funds appeared, was a notion of a firm such as leveraged equities, who would say, well, you have X amount in your portfolio. We can lend against that portfolio for you. And they would structure a product that gave you the capacity to do so. So this is an extrinsic approach to the notion of gearing. You are responsible for the gearing of the fund and all things that flow downstream from that. And as we'll see, there are different responsibilities for each approach. But this raises the question as to should you? And the answer to this will become apparent, I think, as we go along, because each approach has a different risk profile and each requires a slightly different psychology and management approach from the individual investor. I want to look at a hypothetical example using this fund gear, which I mentioned before. And I've highlighted two points in yellow. The first is this notion that if you invest in a geared strategy such as this, you need to be willing to accept a higher volatility and potentially larger moves both up and down. And you can see with this fund that it is geared anywhere between 50 and 65%. And as I said before, you don't have to worry about that. The managers worry about that. But here's the most important part that is often missed. And it is that gearing magnifies gains and losses and may not be a suitable strategy for all investors. So we need to rewind that statement a little bit. Because what people see is the notion that gearing magnifies their gains. The notion that it might magnify their losses disappears out of the consciousness. Because remember, people have been educated to believe that shares only ever go up. So in terms of looking at this as, let's say, proof of concept, what I've done is I have selected the S&P ASX 200 Total Return Index as the vehicle I'll use. And I have done that for a specific reason, and it's a strategic reason. What happens when people undertake any form of geared investment, I'm talking about extrinsic now, is that the notion they're sold is that if you have a portfolio of high dividend paying stocks, then those stocks pay for or self-fund the borrowings. And that to a degree is true, but that falls into a trap that catches people out with investment strategies across the board. They're investing for taxation. They're not investing for profit. My view is that you invest for profit and you allow the tax issue to take care of itself. And in fact, my somewhat strict rule is, within the boundaries of what is legal, the more tax you pay, the better you are doing, the less you need to shut up about it, and the less you need to worry about it. The aim of all investing should be, at the back of your mind, that you pay as much tax as humanly possible, because you are making as much money as humanly possible. So what I've done here, the dichotomy is that those people who take the dividend as cash and use it to self-fund the investment process are making a mistake. And they're making a mistake because they're not making use of a facility called dividend reinvestment programs, whereby instead of taking the dividend in cash, you take it as shares that are given to you. And to illustrate the point, and this point is universal, I've compared the value of a dollar invested in the ASX 200 total return versus the ASX 200 price only. And you can see the tremendous differential that occurs. This differential is worth more to you than self-funding the loan. So keep that in the back of your mind, because this is the vehicle I will use for this particular point of comparison. This raises the question as to why do people gear? And the answer is really quite simple. It is this: you get a tremendous differential in return. And what I've done here is I've assumed that this is very much a surrogate for the beta shares gear fund. So I've geared this to the notion of 50%. And you can see the differential in return. It's quite stark. But this differential in return comes at a cost, because nothing is free. And there is always a symmetry, if not managed carefully, between drawdown and returns. And this is the drawdown curve for both these instruments. And it's going back to the year 2000. And you can see that the geared fund has substantially higher drawdowns than simply price only. The moment you gear an investment and you do not manage the drawdowns will be deeper and they will be much more savage. And you can see in particular here the GFC and the little COVID pop that we had. And you can see that in both, the geared fund has a much larger drawdown. This is the point that I want to get across with geared investments. They have the capacity to generate these returns, but if not managed, you have to put up with this level of drawdown. Now, this goes back 23 years. I thought I would shorten the time frame and squeeze the GFC out of it to see what sort of differential that generated. And you can see that the performance difference initially after the GFC is not that great. The two funds bumble along together and they do take some time to get going to really recover. This is the thing with drawdowns. One of the issues that people struggle with is this notion that if I lose 10%, a 10% gain on what I have left will not get me back to my starting point. It requires 11.1%. So after a savage drawdown, funds take a while to get going. It takes some time to recover from the damage that's been done. But you can see once we get to, let's say 2014, 2015, 2016, we start to see once again the acceleration in the geared fund. But again, we can see with COVID, that nasty pop, and we can see the drawdown, and that's exemplified in the drawdown curve. It still has that same basic look of, yes, we do well when things get going, but we do really badly when things fall apart. This is this notion, again, of that gearing maximizes gains, but it also maximizes losses. This returns to the old notion that gearing or leverage is a double-edged sword. That's simply the way it works. It has symmetry, and it is up to you to manage the symmetry in such a way that you generate an asymmetry so that you can take advantage of the gains, but you are not savaged by the drawdowns. Yes, the drawdowns will occur. There is no way to avoid that. All trading systems, all investment approaches have this issue of drawdown. Nothing we can do. But what it highlights is that there are times to be in the market and times not to be in the market. And if you're using a geared index product, there are times to be in the index and geared, and there are times to be in cash. But this requires the investor or the trader to have some mechanism of defining what that is. When are those times? Because the old notion of you simply buy something and hold it is simply bullshit, and it doesn't work. And we've seen that before, and I'll highlight that again towards the end. So you must have a mechanism of saying, right, today is a good day to be in the market. It may not be a good day to be in the market in 2 or 3 years' time. And the unfortunate thing with the Australian market and our index-based geared products is that it's my contention that the last true broad bull market we had in the Australian market began 20 years ago and ended with the GFC in 2007. Since then, we've had a market that, whilst it has moved upwards, has done so in a very lackluster, meandering fashion. It's certainly not a patch on something like the NASDAQ 100, which has had explosive growth for numerous years. And so that's a consideration that you need to keep in the back of your mind. If you're going to gear an investment, you need to have an investment that generates a return that is worthy of taking on that risk. But this leads me to this very unpleasant point for extrinsically geared instruments. Drawdown brings with it the inevitable margin call if you're using a margin loan. So if you're using one of these extrinsic or borrowed fund tools, sooner or later, you will get a tap on the shoulder that will say to you, you have two choices. You may sell down your investment, or you may add funds to it. This is what a margin call is. And there is a very old strict rule in trading / investing. You never answer a margin call, because a margin call is a sign that something has gone wrong. For example, if we flip back to this chart of the ASX 200 and we look at, let's say, the GFC, if you were to get a margin call in the first week of the GFC and did not take it defensive action by closing out the positions, guess what would happen? You would get a margin call next week, and the week after, and the week after, and the week after, and you would get continual margin calls for probably 18 months. So you would literally be throwing equity into the market when it's not generating a return that makes it worthy of doing that. It is often said, though, that, or it's implied, let's say it's implied, that good shares do not have drawdowns. Well, firstly, we need to define what a good share is, and nobody ever seems to be able to do that. But that also flies in the face of reality. This is National Bank, which is a stock which features heavily in margin loan portfolios. The orange line you see drawn across the bottom of this chart is the 20% drawdown mark. There would be innumerable years where if you're a margined investor in National Bank, you would be margin called repeatedly because the stock simply does not generate the return that is necessary to recover from the previous hits. You can see that with the GFC, National Bank took 6 years to recover and make a new high. It then promptly gave that new high up for another 15 months or so. And the situation gets worse when you consider stocks such as AMP, which is currently in a 75% drawdown. Yet, strangely enough, this stock still appears on the margin loan list of margin lending providers. So we have this notion of trying to balance grossing up our returns by using margin versus this notion of how do we manage that? The first step is to realize that stocks draw down. You will recognize this table from a previous video I did looking at equal weighted portfolios versus index weighted portfolios for the ASX Top 20. And you can see the level of drawdown that even so-called good stocks experience when they get a hammering. And that the average drawdown here was 51%, so the investment's halved. That's more than sufficient to trigger a margin call. So again, we come back to this balancing act. How do we manage this symmetry that appears between drawdown and return? And in actual fact, the larger the stock, the more prone it is to asymmetry. And by that I mean, you will get the drawdown, but not the consequent increase in returns. So for example, if I was trading something like Chalice Mining, I will accept a 70% drawdown because the stock went from $1 to $9. I'm not going to accept an 80% drawdown in AMP because AMP, whilst you do not want to speak in absolutes, will not go from the low $1 to $9. So I'm caught in this asymmetry, and that's problematic for portfolio investors. They have to perhaps be more astute in their approach to how they select stocks and how they manage them as they go along. Because remember, a margin loan is exactly what it says on the tin. It's a loan. The people who loan you the money will want their money back at some point in time. And if it looks to them like the situation might have arose where you may not be able to pay that money back, they have a lien over your shares, which they will sell, as is their right. This is no different to, for example, let's use a simple example, owning a home where you fall behind on the mortgage payments. The bank has every right to sell your home out from under you because their investment is at risk. This raises the question of, should you? To gear or not to gear, that is the question, to bastardise Shakespeare. The answer is a qualified perhaps. And I say qualified because it depends upon two functional aspects of trading. The first is understanding that drawdowns occur. The second is understanding that you can manage these drawdowns. You do not have to sit there like a deer in the headlights, waiting to be run over. It is quite possible for you to sell a share that is not doing well. The last time I looked, there was no law in any exchange in the world that said you cannot sell a share that is a dud. I understand that many investors act as if that is a written rule, that they could not possibly ever sell a share that is a dud. But let me disavow you of that belief. You are able to sell shares that are duds. So you do not have to be a victim of these drawdowns. You do not have to be the victim of a margin call. And even with an index product, even with an intrinsically geared index product like the beta shares product, You do not have to sit there and take a hammering. That's the same as any other investment or trade. If it's hit a point at which you are uncomfortable with it, you simply sell it. But it also comes down to this notion that also seems to be very hard for people to accept. There are times to be in indexes, shares, options, futures, and there are times not to be in them. Just as there is no rule that says you cannot sell a share that is a dud, there is no rule that says you must be in the market fully committed all the time. There are times to be in markets and there are times to be in individual instruments. And if you are going to use leverage of any sort, it is important that you recognize the differential between the two.